You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. And if you're wondering, Billy, why you all low energy except that hello, which was really high pitched, high energy, and I'm now paranoid of woken up everyone in this house. It's past 9 o'clock, so you know what that means. I'm going to ramble for a while. My guest might speak at some point. We don't know. It'll be an hour later. We'll see how it goes. Joining me at this time, last time he was on, it was about a year ago, and I am absolutely shocked and baffled because I was going through the accomplishments since our last chat. I thought, oh, it must have been at least 2 years. It was not. I am joined by the hardest wrestler in Fife, Omar Muhammad's personal demon. It is Hunter Samson. Welcome back.
How's it going, man?
I'm excited for this. It's like I said, it's been straight a year, and I thought, oh, we've got loads to speak about. It's fine. It must have been ages since the last had you on, and yeah, November 23.
It's been a year, I tell you that, so.
I had a look at the last episode that we did and seeing my background of less merch and crap, and I've somehow gained.
You've got more Funkos.
Too many.
And more titles, I think.
The titles were still the same. I've now just displayed them more. For those that are keeping track,
European belt was always a winner.
The best one. But I've got a little plastic one behind it because I found it at a car boot sale, and my son was with me. And he was like one at the time when I found it. I was like, the boy needs a belt. And I saw that one and I was like, yes, it's that one. That's the one. We could both have it. We can
Wise choice. Years wanting the European belt.
That's it. It was options were rotten, to be honest, but that was the best one. The foam belts with the actual sides same width, same length. Maybe these rubbish plastic ones now, which one side's longer than the other, so the kids can put them on. We had to earn putting the belts on us. We had to try and turn them round.
And now they cost about 200 quid now, it shows. What's going on with that?
Absolute madness. I mean, my European was 120. Thank you, eBay.
Today's standard, that's a bargain.
It is. I don't think I could ever get that price again. Although I'm seeing all these. This is the weirdest start of the podcast I've went with. I haven't even asked.
I'm just popping question. For the European belt. I'm sorry, man. It's one of my favorites. So
it is. People love it. It's an underrated belt. And every time that a European or that wins the IC title or United States titles, the first question is always the same. So when are you making it the European belt? That's what we
exactly.
want.
Exactly.
Rusev, exactly. Cesaro, all these people, like, when is it going to be it? But one day. For anyone else who watches the video, they'll know that there's something missing from this wall as well. That massive monstrosity of an Avengers poster. Yes, it did fall off the wall again, and it broke.
That's the universe telling you something, man.
It is. I had, like, loads of, like, figures and Lego in this shelf, and I had I had the picture behind it, and I came home, and it just... most stuff's now broken in a box, so that's why the belt's
just leave it on the floor. I'll be fine down there.
I might break something on the way out. Anyway, this is an interview with Hunter Samson. This is not the diatribe of past 9 o'clock 30-year-olds speaking. I have underestimated.
I mean, we've already started rambling. I mean, we've fulfilled the promise already.
We have, exactly. It's what, 5 minutes in. Yeah, how's it going?
It's going well. It's going well. It's been a year. Done a lot. Wrestled a lot. I started the year strong. I'm continuing on. The year's not finished yet. I hope to get a few more big matches under my belt before the year's over. But I'm sure we can get that sorted soon.
Absolutely. I mean, you should do. Because by the time this episode comes out, we'll probably be a week or so away from Pro2 Wrestling's one of the biggest events of the year, Battle Lines, which will... We'll get into that story in a little bit, but first we'll dive right back to November 23. So last time we spoke, it was just after, probably just after Battlelines last year, when you had the four-way, with David Blaze and Frank Cross and Hammerhead Smith. So that was the interpromotional championship at the time.
The gauntlet, the famous gauntlet. First out, first eliminated. Brilliant.
Well, I mean, look at you now, though, a year later. And,
I know, a year later. Exactly. I'm going to win it.
I mean, that first year, but did you reflect come like November that year after we had our chat, after the episode went out, were you able to reflect on your first year and just think, my God, I mean, there's a few matches in there. You had some pretty big matches, title matches in that time as well. Were you able to reflect back and think of how your first year went and what were your thoughts on it?
Yeah, I think my first year went okay as far as first years go. Granted, I didn't wrestle quite as much as I'd like. Certainly not compared to this year, anyway. This year's kind of just taken off like crazy. I mean, I started in March, and it's been non-stop. I mean, most weekends I've been, you know, I've been wrestling somewhere. But the first year, I think it was more, I mean, we touched on this last year, and it was more kind of, it was finding my feet, you know, people being introduced to me, you know, getting to know what I'm all about. And hopefully people know what I'm all about now, and they can see that. I mean, yeah, a few title matches here and there. Came up short, but now it comes full circle. This year, main event, Battle Lines, heavyweight title match. I finally get redemption against old TJ Ridge.
I mean, making those contacts and making all those Pro2 being one of them. So you return to a lot of places like your fair city and well, Power Pro, obviously. It would be silly if you didn't actually return to Power Pro, as soon as that's where you started.
That'd be strange, wouldn't it?
I know, that'd be a very weird circumstance. But were you finding like it was very easy to kind of, not very easy, but you were able to kind of make these connections quite easily and it moved on to opportunities elsewhere, or are you one of those people that kind of like a bit more reserved when you meet people?
No, not at all. It's strange as well because we were talking about this on last year's podcast. I remember we were just talking about people I'd like to face, and I'm sure one of them was like Caleb Valhalla, and I've already wrestled him like three times this year. It was one of the guys I started the year with in FCW. But yeah, no, I'll happily take on anyone and anyone. So no matter who it is. And in terms of, you know, promotions and stuff, I think, you know, Power Pro, FCW, Pro2, even been wrestling for Mega Slam as well, because Power Pro is now affiliated with Mega Slam. Up and down the country, England, Wales, been debuting there, which is crazy. We travelled down to Wales, you know, for basically just 7 in the morning, travelled down to Wales, done two shows, travelled back up the same night, didn't get into like 4 in the morning, and then had to do a Pro2 show the next day. So it's been a crazy busy year, but I actually wouldn't have it any other way.
Those Mega Slam shows. So yeah, Power Pro, for those who are unaware, yeah, Power Pro, Andy and the Power Pro team, they kind of take on a lot of the Mega Slam tours, especially north of the border and Wales and other places around the country, around the UK. Getting involved with that, though, was that the biggest learning experience you could probably have? Because you're in front of people that are not necessarily all wrestling fans, because it's just people who are going, oh, there's wrestling on. It's what? I know. Fiver. Let's go.
I know. It's the camp shows. It's the old school kind of Butlins camp show style. You're basically going to these camps. You're wrestling in front of, you know, your parents are just taking their kids for something to do on a Sunday. And it is a learning curve, because before I did Mega Slam, things like, you know, crowd work are essential in these shows, because, you know, you're having to force feed and spoon feed what you're doing to them. Whereas if your normal kind of indie show, they kind of know what to expect and they know the heel, the face, you know, but you have to literally educate these guys on what you're doing. I remember being a good story about whenever you go to Orlando, the performance center, like guys like Brookside and Regal and stuff, they absolutely love if you work like the kind of Mega Slam style shows and the camp shows, because half the battle is working the crowd, and that's what those shows are primarily often about. So I'm happy I got to dip my toes in there. It's also been invaluable in helping me build my confidence and stuff and crowd work, because before I'd done these shows, I was kind of not too much reserved, but, you know, focusing more on the wrestling, focusing on the in-ring work, and, you know, sometimes crowd work and interaction will slip by the wayside, but you're literally forced to do that on these Mega Slam shows.
I suppose when it comes to yourself, there's a lot of big lads about in Scotland right now anyway, but for yourself, as soon as you come out, fucking going,
yeah.
Oh my God, you could have got by a lot longer than you should have on just on that alone, just on the shock value of you coming out. So
it's not a shoot. It's a legit shoot. Sorry, mm-hmm. I'm 6'7" and 270 pounds. You know, and it's sometimes when I come through the curtain, there is that, you know, the audible gasp that you hear. It's like, oh, he's actually that big, you know? Mm-hmm. You know.
It's seeing those camp shows, you meeting those people, like the non-fans at all, and I've got a feeling that you've had a few, like the old Polaroids in the picture in the middle of the ring, that you've had a few of the dads coming up thinking they could, like, maybe telling you about the old giant haystacks and all that kind of stuff. Is that just part and part of the parcel now?
Of the old big daddy and giant haystacks thing.
Aye, of course, yeah.
Get that a lot. You just kind of go, I know, yeah. But it's a little bit before my time as well, even, so you just kind of have to be like, oh, yeah, I remember that, yeah. McManus days and all that.
Oh, aye. Kendo Nagasaki, aye. Yeah, best pals. Can them. So, yeah, you said you started March this year, which was the fatal five-way. Coming into that, though, that wasn't how your year really started. It was a lot of build-up on the lead-up to this with a certain TV megastar from Family Fortunes and Bollywood and whoever else his IMDb may or may not say, with a certain Omar Muhammad.
Actually, Family Fortunes' finest.
Before that was Tommy Cartel. You still had Tommy Cartel to wrap up stuff with, and that led into the hardest.
I know. It seems to be these five ways. They just breed rivalries for me. I don't know what it is. You know, Tommy Cartel, Omar Muhammad.
It must be good to kind of get your teeth into like proper thing, which the Meg Slam stuff would have helped with that as well. But to actually getting about with a bit of a story behind you and an investment as well was. What was it like working with that lead up with Tommy? And we'll get into Omar a lot more, but getting into that back and forth with Omar as well.
Yeah. Aye, because we did this November kind of last year, so I've not spoke to you since we've done the Leaving Street fight.
Yes.
You know, it was good. It's always good to have a rivalry because you've got a kind of body of work to look back on. Granted, came up short against old TK in the first Leaving Street fight. But it was a hell of a match. We brawled on and Truth Nightclub and, you know, weapons used. He used a pool ball and a sock to beat me, which is to be fair, what you're going to need to use to beat me. Knock me unconscious. You know, you have to literally make me stop breathing. But yeah, in terms of Mega Slam and stuff, and just the one thing I would say, and going with the rivalries and stuff like that, it does get a bit more eyes on you and a bit more attention. I mean, I've spent since March in this kind of storyline Omar. I'm getting a bit sick of him now, to be honest. You know, he's popping up. I'm still living rent-free in that head of his. But he just can't let it go. He's going around saying that he beat me and stuff. And, you know, too many powerbombs can do that to you. Do you know what I mean? Like, you get powerbombed by me, you're high. You're up high in there, in the last ride of them there. So, you know, it wasn't just a powerbomb in that last show. I gave him the old school Undertaker.
Of course, yeah, the old last ride. I saw some of the clips because I've appreciated it online, but Power Pro, their production and putting out things on social media is incredible right now. What's it like getting to wrestle in Truth Nightclub? Because what I'm seeing the clips and the crowd, things like that, the crowd are thirsty for wrestling. They want to see a show. They're here to see it. And that must make like everything just a little bit, I don't, not easier. Easier is definitely the word, but a bit more amped up and a bit more like, must just add an extra bit of energy, a bit of spice to whatever you're doing in the ring.
Oh, 100%. I mean, Truth Nightclub is, you know, not just because I'm from there, but it's becoming one of my favourite venues to wrestle in. Just the aesthetic of it, the production. Like you're saying there, you touched on it, just the way it looks. It just looks cool. Mm-hmm. And in terms of the fan base and stuff, we're growing a fan base. You're seeing faces return for a lot of these shows. You know, at the start, there was a lot of new faces. You didn't really know about the product. But the more we do shows, every single Truth show, you're seeing familiar faces in the crowd. They get to know who you are. They get to know the storylines. I said it before, but those Truth shows are special. That will forever be one of my favourite venues to perform in. And not just because I'm from Leaving, but just it just looks cool, and the production value is class.
Yeah, the big old sign, the big old truth sign. I think it's becoming, I think promotions and Power Pro, probably one of the first ones recently, are really starting to latch on to the social media, things like the post-show, pre-show stuff. I know Valor did it recently. Yep. Iron Girders started doing it as well. It seems like a lot of promotions are realizing that's it's not only the content in the ring as well, it's everything around about it has to be top quality. And
100%.
I've seen just a couple hours ago, Instagram, seeing Power Pro doing kind of photo shoots and sit downs and talking heads and stuff like that. And it seems like Andy and the team and Hannah and everyone else involved, they're not just making a wrestling company, they're literally making a wrestling promotion. Promoting their guys. Is that how it feels for yourself in that environment?
Yeah, 100%. It's not just a couple of shows we're putting on here and there. We're building a brand, a promotion. I genuinely believe that we're one of the top promotions in Scotland with the level of talent we put on, the level of matches, the quality of them, and the level of people. You can just look at the people we bring in, you know, Rampage Brown, Sam Gradwell, Rob Drake, all these kind of people. That's the kind of level they want to work for us. And we can compete as one of the best. And like you're saying about social media as well, like, you need it. I mean, in this day and age, you know, if you've not got a social media following or a presence on social media, no one's really going to see you. No one's going to know what you're all about. They're going to have to go off like maybe a poster on a high street or something like that. Mm-hmm. And you kind of need to build your brand on social media in a way that is eye-catching. And with the stuff we done at the last show with, you know, Ben from Soul Sessions interviewing us, and post-show, pre-show, you know, even just filming us going into the venue and stuff like that, you know, I think we've kind of leveled up, and we're definitely ones to watch in the near future.
I mean, speaking of that, I think it was last year that at Power Pro got a hell of a lot of votes in our year-end awards, whether people believe in them or not. But they got a lot of votes in, and it showed that generally, because we get the criticism at our site that we're very northeast based and biased and all that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. But the fact that people went, no, we got show that Pro Wrestling Ready is going to be the promotion to watch, and I think I'm fairly certain you won, if not one, definitely the top three. You're there. So it just goes to show people are watching and are paying attention, and like they should be, because I'm seeing people coming out of it and they're ready. Yeah. They're ready to go. Yourself, Frank Gallo, Daisy Jenkins, and these people are coming out with the par. These guys are coming out ready as a full package.
100%. I mean, it's all testament to the coaching, to be honest. We've got Andy Roberts, 19 years in. You know, he's one of the veterans of the UK scene. You know, a wealth of knowledge. And we're all trained by him, and we basically, he instills his values in us. So, you know, that's the quality we're getting. So, and we can, I wholeheartedly believe that we can perform on any show in Scotland and the UK just purely from his training and his guidance.
I mean, of course, because he came through he spent a little bit of time at the performance center. Through things like NXT UK, he's done tryouts. So he knows what they're looking for if you're looking to level up into the next stage of things.
Yeah, he knows what basically any kind of big company is looking for. If you're looking to take that next step, whether it be in America, Japan, or whatever, or any kind of big promotion, he's been there, he's dipped his toes. All the feedback that he's gotten, he's kind of passes on to us, and like, right, this is what you need to be doing if you want to catch eyes here, there. Do you know what I mean? Like, even in drills and stuff like that, aggression, intensity, crowd work, these are all things that they'll look for, and he instills that in us. So yeah.
I mean, we mentioned crowd work a couple of times. Was that the bit that you did you feel that was your kind of missing puzzle piece, or is there something that you feel like there's just, if once you nail that, that's, you're pretty much you're just come get me kind of thing?
Yeah, I mean, I 100% I believe that in-ring stuff is fine, you know, but if you can't draw the crowd into what you're doing, or they're not going to believe it, then there's no real point in doing anything, because they can just get bored or whatever. But you need to kind of bring them in and make them feel the same kind of emotion that you're going through. Whether you're a heel, face, you know, you've kind of got to make them feel that they're involved. And like I'm saying with the camp shows, like, that's a necessity almost.
Yeah. I mean, I could list off like maybe my top 5-10 matches I've ever seen live, I could not tell you a move that happened in them, but I could tell you how I felt.
Exactly. It's all about the moments. All about the moments.
So we'll get into some matches then. Speaking of moments and matches, you mentioned a little bit about facing Caleb like numerous times, and a big favourite of Caleb, I'm very much a fan of Caleb Valhalla and what he does. It must be great to wrestle someone who can match, kind of, or at least come up with you when it comes to strength. And is it kind of a little bit of a novelty when you can get ragdolled a little bit in comparison to what you're usually up against?
He's a strong boy, I'll give him that. But when he strikes you. So I think it's a lot different getting hit by him than it is a cruiserweight. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I annoyingly like him now.
That's irritating.
it's hard not to love that guy. But no, I've had a couple of great matches. Caleb's been involved in. I wrestled ADM for FCW in March. He was a special guest referee. A lot of shenanigans there. Came out on top of that, so cheers, Caleb. And then the Fatal 4-Way for FCW the following month, which was me, ADM, Caleb Valhalla, and Bruiser Brad. Mm-hmm. Which is probably the biggest Fatal 4-Way match you can ever have in Scotland. Or the UK, or dare I say it, the UK.
I gave that a watch. I watched it, and I think it was, maybe like 10 minutes or something. It was a sprint. It pretty much, you four guys were just leathering the utter piss out of each other for about 10 minutes.
That's what it needed to be. I mean, you've got us four guys in the ring. It's going to be a war. It's going to be an absolute collision. And I was sore for about a week after it.
So we mentioned in our previous podcast about inspirations, and I know you're a big Triple H guy and all that kind of stuff. In this last year since we had a chat, has there been anyone that you've kind of drawn towards that's maybe helped your complete your in-ring persona, or just something that's you've kind of been able to pick and use yourself?
I'll tell you who I've been watching recently, and it's just because he's one of the most underrated big men of all time. And even Undertaker said it recently, it was JBL. Just not so much the accolade either, but when he became JBL, looks like a completely different guy as well, which is insane. But watching his matches, say he's against Guerrero or Mysterio, just the way he moves, the clothesline from hell is something else as well. But I think JBL was the main one I've kind of watched over the last kind of few months or so, and kind of taking bits from here and there.
I can see you also being a guy that when Sid passed, that Sid must be a guy, Sid Justice Vicious, wherever, Psycho Sid, wherever incarnation he was, he's a must be a guy that popped into your radar more than once for an inspiration somewhere.
I mean, Sid's the whole reason I do the powerbomb. It's a kind of Sid style powerbomb, kind of Jack Knife-esque. Sid was a massive, I mean, still is a massive inspiration. Shame recently what happened to him. Just one of those guys from that era, isn't it? He kind of, it won't be long. But Sid, I remember watching Sid's ever first match recently, and he just absolutely ragdolls the guy. And we were talking about that audible kind of gasp before, where someone comes out of the, the exit, they enter from the curtain, and there's that kind of shock factor, there's that gasp. I mean, he had it. He had it all. He had size. He had the look, he had the intensity. Admittedly, maybe the only place he lacked it was, the mic skills, but even that, it was just, he only ever needed to be what he was. Mm-hmm. And that was just, that level of just quiet, just intensity. Almost like kind of how Jake Roberts was. His promos were never loud. Mm-hmm. They were never, he was almost, haunting in the way he talked. Kind of like how I think Bray Wyatt was kind of like that as well. He took a lot of inspiration from Jake Roberts, and the way it was that quiet promo where I don't need to shout, but you're going to listen to what I say, kind of thing,
Yeah, it's one of those things. If I don't raise my voice, you're going to believe every word I say because I believe it. What it is, but for Sid anyway, it's, you're right with that audible gasp thing, because if you take apart Sid, it shouldn't work. His promo calling out the best, the old noodle perm, not great. But then but you put it all together, it's just an absolute terrifying package of intensity.
I talk about there's maybe two guys that, maybe three actually. I'll say three guys that if you were to make a professional wrestler in a lab from like the ground up, it would probably be one, Randy Orton, two, Scott Hall, and probably three, Sid. Just by look alone, Sid.
So I can't argue with any of those names. And if you're, they kind of can fit any mold if required. But you know,
exactly.
They throw in guys like your Bryan Danielsons and stuff like that. If you're wanting someone that can elicit a reaction yet can keep a match grounded, it's wrestling's fascinating. Yeah. I don't know if you find that now that you're more into the scene and in about and seeing all these different styles come through Power Pro or through Megastar or through Pro 2 or whatever. Is wrestling more exciting for you to watch now, or are you able to switch off and just enjoy it as a fan?
I can actually, I mean, I talked to some people about this and they're like, you know, I watch the matches now that, you know, I critique them. Like, that was a bad bump or whatever. But I'm actually able to switch off and actually watch it as a fan still. You know, if I go to a live event, I'll watch it as a fan. I'll try and not look into why things are happening too much. Or, I mean, when you're watching a match and you need to learn, I mean, you can do that. But in terms of watching it and enjoying it, I mean, I'm able to still do that without being like, obviously being involved in the business now and being like, oh, why is he doing that? Or that's kind of sucky, that shit. But yeah, I'm trying to think of what was I watched recently. I actually remember watching the WWE event in France. Was it Lyon?
Yes.
Every single thing they were popping for. Every single, even just strikes, even just like a stomp, they were just absolutely popping for it. And that's the kind of crowd you're wanting to be in front of. And that's the kind of events that I like watching.
I mean, you're great. The companies that you have worked for primarily or ones that you work with the most, they're all very hungry wrestling fans. We mentioned Truth Nightclub for Power Pro, but the Pro 2 crowds are just as loud and just want to see some wrestling. And 100%. Fair say ones as well. I mean, you've wrestled at the Tulloch and a little bit at the Queen's Hotel as well. But the Tulloch crowds, again, they're all in an enclosed space.
And it's all very close to you as well. It's, you know, there's a lot of regulars there who, you know who I am now. I've got a bit of a following with them. And like the Tulloch, you ever been to the Tulloch?
I've not been to the Tulloch. The only Fair City shows I've been to have been the Ardler.
Any time we've been outside the ring brawling or wrestling, the crowd's right there. So there's not a lot of space for us big guys to move around in. But I remember, I remember in that fatal four-way, Caleb dived out the ring on top of me and Brad, and it was from that much force that I literally nearly took the whole Titantron, the whole setting down, the whole ring. Oh, imagine that had happened. I would have pulled the rug down.
It's just a bit like The Simpsons with Lenny's house, side of his house getting taken down. So
that's exactly what it'd been like. Yeah,
don't let people know how I live. But I think that clip's still in the intro now of Empire. I think that you getting pushed into it. Because I remember, as soon as you said that, I was like, I've seen that very recently because I watched Empire last week.
If you watch it closely, I spin around and I almost take the whole rig down.
I mean, that would have been something. I mean, I don't know. I mean, the old Big Show did it back in 90, whatever, 99.
What do you expect with me and Brad going into something? You know, two big lumps like us, you know?
That must be like high up as a one-on-one match you're wanting to revisit at some, well, revisit as a one-on-one match, you and Big Brad.
I would love it. I will not shy away from that one bit. I think me and Brad would have an absolute stormer. Just two big guys going at it. We got a little bit of a taste in that fatal four-way, but a lot of moving parts there and stuff like that. But as a one-on-one contest, unsure why no one's really saw potential in that. After we did it in April,
is it maybe because you almost took down the rigging unit of the Tulloch? Maybe that was. I mean, maybe
literally we're tearing the house down. Also, another little segue into that is me, Meat Factory against the Foundations of the Future. Six man, it writes itself.
There's
come
some
on,
meaty
someone
matches.
Please, go and someone please book that just for my own sake. I'm tearing my head out trying to get that sorted.
John, obviously, John, it's Kev has got the book. Kev, book it. I've now that's usually a catchphrase on the FCW podcast. I'm now bringing it into this multiverse of madness. Kev, I mean, book it.
that's a main event anyway, to be honest.
God, they just have to reinforce the ring and all sorts of manner of things. So
taking those ratchets.
Just get all sorted to make sure everyone's holding tag ropes, etc.
Exactly.
Meat Factory guys, and you've brought them up, so I'm gonna go with them. Just was it like, because I had them on the podcast together, and we end up having a 10-minute conversation about food, because of course we did. What's it like being around those guys? They seem like they're two knight hearts in a world of Bret Harts.
they're class. I love traveling with them. They've dipped their toes in Pro2 now. So anytime we're both booked on Pro2, we'll travel together. Boys like their food, so do I. So that's always a fun conversation to have. Always a good pit stop, whether it's Nando's, KFC, whatever, you know, post show. But yeah, I love those boys. Would love to, like I was saying, love to team with them. I even more so enjoy watching them. I think they're absolutely fantastic. You know, dare I say it, underrated talents right now. For what they can actually do.
I would certainly say so.
Technically sound as they come. I mean, John Kerr, some of the stuff he can do for a guy his size is unreal. The guy just busts out a moonsault like that. Jacob Fatu style.
It's insane. It's like, I did last year, well, start of this year, I did that, like a list of tag teams, mainly because I knew that they've had to do 24 for 24. The 21st person on that list is going to be unhappy. So I did the tag teams this year, and it was Meat Factory were like the third name I could think of, and since then I think just one on a list of one tag titles, and Meat Factory still without gold, which is just insane to think of, because they are just
They should be everywhere, to be honest.
So hopefully, just for booking sake, so Meat Factory versus Foundation in the future, somewhere soon, I'm sure. It'd probably be Fair City, I'm
please
guessing.
Someone book it. If the right person's watching this, please. Just need that in my life.
Just do it. I'll do commentary. I'm a commentator now when this episode comes out. I'm very excited.
I see you're doing commentary next week, yeah?
Yes, Fair City. I'm so scared. But I'm sure we'll be fine. I'm more scared that it's gonna like I'm just gonna overrun everybody and just like talk nonsense for 3 hours, and they're just like, all right, okay.
It'll be grand.
Be fine. We've got some cracking matches on that card, but unfortunately no Hunter Samson. I'm absolutely disappointed
Foundations, there's no Meat Factory, there's no six man on the Adler Mania. What's going on? Sort it out.
Again, they knew I was coming. Where's my Northeast guys? I need to know. There's a couple.
You could have called that match. You could have been calling it right there.
Could have been. Like next year, Early Mania 3. Get it. Six man. I'll be there.
I hope we don't have to wait that long, to be honest. Selfishly,
I hope we do. From that point onwards, we'll move on. We kind of started a timeline, and then we just spiraled out, because we knew that this was going to happen when we were setting this up and getting this ready. Back to Pro2 for a moment then. So your journey in Pro2 right now is just on the up and up, because you started there, a couple title matches and all that kind of thing, and then you're embroiled in this big rivalry at the top with TJ Rage, Boddington, Davey Blaze and the likes. Talked about the stories and the investments and all that good stuff that goes with it. But how was it like being put right to the top of the card and having the main story that's running through that promotion?
Yeah, 100%. Like I say, I made my debut for Pro2 last August at the first King of the Bing. I saw Logan Smith, came up short. Then it was Battle Lines a month or two later, again coming up short. But ever since this year started, I've just been on the up. The last time I was defeated was TJ Rage in March, and that was for the heavyweight title, which Boddington got involved in, hit me over the head with a briefcase, and that's the reason I'm not currently sitting as the heavyweight champion. But since then, I've just had it's been a fire in me. Anyone that's anyone has been getting it. picking up win after win. I even wrestled my good friend Frank Gallo at one of the shows. Gave me a good scene too, but came up top. And yeah, here we are, full circle, winning King of the Bing, winning that trophy, which got me my spot to wrestle for the heavyweight title and get redemption against TJ Rage in Boddington.
Mm-hmm. And it's going to be the headline. So the King of the Bing first, we'll start with that, with the this year's one. Again, seeing some clips through the As the Dust Settles clips, which are phenomenal production value by Pro2. Couldn't believe it. Oh, yeah. It's like I was there. It was that good. But it looked like a wild night in itself, and getting in about all these people and new, maybe some new faces for yourself and some different faces and familiar ones. When it comes to that moment, you threw Shane Monet was the last person that went out. Am I right thinking that? That moment when his feet touched the floor, the bell rang, you had the win. Obviously, you knew where it was going. You were going to have that match with TJ Rage down the line. But was that your Royal Rumble? Was that your point at the sign, exhale moment as a wrestling fan?
It was my point to the sign moment, if there was a sign. But yeah, eliminated Shane Monet. And I'm almost, that was my ticket back to the heavyweight title. I mean, that's all I wanted. There's that redemption match. Earlier on in that night, I wrestled in a triple threat match against Davey Blaze and Silas Everett. I came out on top in that one. Two formidable foes. Again, Davey Blaze, who's part of Boddington's crew. Had a little bit of back and forth tussles with him. One at Press Fest, the other in that triple threat match. That's another match I'd like to run back. One on one. But yeah, that was definitely the, you know, winning that King of the Bing was the moment I was like, right, this is me back. Heavyweight title match. Let's get redemption here. Let's not let any mistakes happen again. Let's not just, you know, foot 100% on the gas with this one. You know, TJ Rage, he's got Boddington. I mean, who's to say that I've not had a little bit of help along the way in Pro 2, a little bit of someone guiding me recently. This is the reason that I've been picking up all these wins. It's kind of someone in my ear, keeping me right. So all will be revealed soon with that one.
A little tease, little throwing a tease there. So it's October 20th, Battle Lines at Troon, is it? Oh, I should have had this information in front of me. But
Troon Walker Hall.
I'm going to get the times up as well, just so it keeps. Cameron on my side here for results and whatnot. There we go. Just get this. Battle Lines, 20th of October. The only match announced as we are recording is yourself versus TJ Rage. Doors open 4 p.m. Tickets available at pro2wrestlingonlinestore.bigcartel.com. Get your tickets for that. Tickets £10 each plus a small booking fee. Bargain. Absolute bargain to see the rematch of the year, the decade. Why not? Let's throw all the hyperbole at it. That's what we're going to do. Considering all that, you know, I'm throwing that hyperbole in, if that's the word, if that is a word, I'll find out a word later.
That is a word.
You can come back from, is this your WrestleMania moment? I suppose it was the best way to put it, considering that you started, came back from hellish injury, if I remember rightly, become a wrestler. And you've done these tours, you've travelled to Wales, you've done the long drives, you've been going everywhere trying to just tweak and perfect every part of your craft. Right now, is this all that it's leading to? Is this the culmination of the last 2 years for you?
Yeah, I mean, everyone wants to be a champion, don't they? Everyone wants to have that belt either round their waist, over their shoulder. And I think it'll be validating in a way. That'd be good, because it's the Ish or Believe Heavyweight Championship is what it's called, and most of my family's from Ayrshire. I spent many summer holidays in Ayrshire growing up. Ayrshire actually holds a strong place in my heart, to be honest. So being the Ayrshire Heavyweight Champion will mean more to me than some people think. Obviously it's called the Believe Championship, closely associated with Lionheart, who was one of my first ever coaches in professional wrestling. So again, it's got a little another little meaning there. So yeah, this is going to be one of those moments where I'm not going to let anything get in my way. It's going to be gung ho, all guns blazing, and I'm going to pull out every single stop that I can to be the new Pro 2 heavyweight champion.
Not to steal a cliche from the last 2 years, but you're going to finish your story.
I'm going to finish the story.
This
I'm
is
going
the
to
chapter.
Finish the story. Aye.
That emotional moment that we had there, and we spoke about something that's heavily close to your heart. We'll go back to Power Pro for a moment to speak about somebody who was very close to you as you were lifting him and throwing him for a powerbomb. What do you think? Why do you think Omar Mohammed's decided to pick a fight with you? Why did he decide to pick a fight with you?
He seems to think I'm a fraud. I wasn't announced technically for the first Fatal 5-Way. He was on the microphone flapping his gums, as he usually does, about he was the biggest, the strongest. I was back there, I turned to Andy and I say, look, give me some of this guy. I go out, powerbomb him, basically through the ring, pin him 1-2-3, and ever since then, he's just have a bitter taste in his mouth. Just a salty taste in his mouth about it. And ever since then, I've been living rent-free in his head, even on social media. Constantly tagging me and stuff and trying to call me out, trying to get his goons on me in the June show for Power Pro. But again, came out tops on that, got rid of them. And even last month there, for our show, Power Pro, Lumberjack match, he pulled a sleazy trick. He paid off a referee, eliminated all my lumberjacks from ringside, to try and gain the upper hand. Just a sleazy underhanded move that I wasn't surprised about. He's that kind of guy, delusional guy as well. But again, the outcome was always the same. The last three shows for Power Pro, I've got the better of this guy. Some people just have your number, and I'm afraid to say, Omar Mohammed, I'm one of those guys.
Yeah, I just don't understand what Levin does to Omar. Because when he comes up here, he's all nice, he's respectful, he's dancing, and then he goes down there and he's just bitter. I don't know if it's just the air or what.
He's bitter about me, I'm telling you that.
Speaking of Omar Mohammed, no, it's not like the Soul Sessions. I did not divulge. He has not hacked into this.
Oh, is he going to appear somewhere?
No. He sent me a lengthy DM, which I've had to edit for, you know. I mean, we're not monetized, but I feel like a lot of this had to be taken out. So I'll just tell you what I can tell you, and we'll pick up as we go. There's quite a few paragraphs. So he has asked that jabroni giant Hunter Samson if he's better prepared for this interview than he was with the Soul Sessions one, where I absolutely slaughtered him. So we'll start with that bit. So of course, our friend, good friend Ben at Soul Sessions, he had you guys on. Well, had you on, and. Omar made an appearance. That's not the first time he's jumped into podcast. He's jumped into one of ours in the past. He's just he's paid somebody to just jump into these things. Somebody at Zoom needs to probably be monitored.
Somebody works for Zoom that also works for Family Fortunes probably, so he's probably in their pocket.
Well, you know, I mean, he probably thinks that Omar is Judge Judy and executioner in these sorts of situations. But yeah, that kind of tete-a-tete back and forth, did that just backfire for him because it just made you angrier and want to give him that last ride?
Yeah, he just couldn't. He can't ever let me have any moments or anything. He's going around saying he beat me as well, which is crazy. The footage speaks for itself. Last ride straight through the mat again, and I'm just, to be honest, I think that should be it. You know, that's three times now I've got the better of him. 1-2-3. You know, he should be in the rear view mirror now, but he still has to keep flapping his gums. He's even writing you little paragraphs to tell me on an interview that you're meant to be doing with me. Like, he just can't let it go, can he? I'm always going to be rent-free in that guy's head. He's just delusional narcissist that deserves to have no one give him any sort of attention.
That kind of works nicely into the next paragraph. A nice short one. There's loads. Then ask that fraudulent piece of trash why I was the greatest thing to happen to his career.
Brilliant.
We'll move to the next one, Lily. Also ask him if my makeup artist paid him that visit for the SWN interview to hide the bruises as a result of that slap I gave him.
Is that it?
Or just one more.
There's one more. Keep going.
One more. Lastly, ask him how he feels that I've beaten Caleb Valhalla and Bruiser Brad on my own when he couldn't do it in singles or a fatal four-way, yet claims to be the hardest man in Fife.
Well, I've got an answer for that. I've never wrestled Caleb or Bruiser Brad in a one-on-one match. So the point's redundant there. He's going on saying that he's beat them both before. Well done. I'm sure you have. And me and Caleb one-on-one. Would love that. Me and Brad, one-on-one, would love that. But like we touched on before, no one's really give that a shot yet. I mean, I'm sure it's definitely still to come. I'm sure our paths are going to meet. But unlike Mr. Muhammad, those two guys will actually be formidable foes. Who will actually give me a run for my money, unlike the last three shows where I've got the best of them and absolutely humiliated them. But yeah, and in terms of the slap, yeah, belter. I'll give him credit for that. There's a photo somewhere where he's slapping me and the sweat's all coming off me. He slapped the sweat off me. Brilliant. But nailed him with his Oscar, lash-righted him right after it. So, if the best that he's got is a silly little slap to my face, then I'll give him that.
I mean, this has to end at some point. So, surely... It's 'Twas the Night at Christmas 3. Nothing's been announced, nothing's been confirmed, but surely this is much like you put. I mean, Tommy Cartel did get the win, but you kind of put him in your review minner last year. This year, you're going to have to put it's Omar has to go. You're going to have to give a Christmas gift for everyone at Power Pro.
He's talking about how, like, ask him why I'm the greatest thing to ever happen to his career, but he seems to be holding on and latching on to me a lot for a guy that thinks that. So I'll just leave it at that.
So we'll leave Omar to the side at the moment. I'm sure the next time I do one of those...
I actually make Omar Muhammad relevant, so clip that.
I'm sure he will.
I'm sure he'll love that.
So let's back to you yourself, not with Omar, but just yourself only. We mentioned the matches, your title match coming up, which is possibly where all your thoughts are right now when it comes to going forward. We've mentioned things like dream matches or matches that you want to tick off sooner rather than later with the old six man and what have you. 2 years in, there seems to be no kind of ceiling for you right now, other than winning belts and traveling places. Yeah. What's your bucket list for next year? Is there promotions that you want? I know the cliche answer. I know I always ask this question, and the answer is always going to be the same. Everyone and everywhere, but give me a couple of names, a couple of places. Where are you looking to try and tick off in the next 12 months?
I mean, I know it, like you're saying, it is a cliche about places you want to wrestle, and that was before you even said that. There, it was going to be my answer. As many places as I can that gives me the opportunity to wrestle people that I want to wrestle and level up against. I would absolutely love. You know, the chance, I mean, he's been up a couple of times, but one of my dream matches, not even just in the UK as a realistic one, but one of my dream matches ever is Rampage Brown. I've watched Rampage Brown for years, and I'm talking like since 2012 or something like that. Always been a fan of him, always loved his hard-hitting, aggressive style. Some of my styles based off of him, dare I say. I've absolutely loved him. It's an absolute pleasure being on shows with him as well. Lovely guy. And we've done a seminar with him as well. Last September, I think it was. I took away so much. Learned so much lessons with that one. And he's also someone that, you know, you can shoot a message to and he'll reply to you. You know, what do you think about this or whatever like that. So it's kind of surreal in a way. Another one would be, I'm trying to think as well. I would love to wrestle someone like Big Damo. Mm-hmm. I think Big Damo is another name that I would love to wrestle as a heavyweight. I just think that he's another guy I've watched, since he started to get a bit of a name in ICW. I've always thought he's just fantastic heavyweight, doesn't move like a guy his size should. So yeah, Rampage Brown demo. I'd love to wrestle. I'd love the chance to wrestle my coach Andy Roberts.
I was literally just control effing to see if you had a match with Andy yet. That was when what I was doing.
I know.
Just background there.
I know. Anytime I do like Instagram, you know, where do you want to see me wrestle, or who do you want to see me wrestle against? It's legit. It's nearly in double figures the amount of times it's Andy Roberts. Maybe it's just because he's my coach and another guy, but he's another guy I would love to step in the ring with. It'd be an absolute honour. But yeah, in terms of places, you know, you've got your usual ones, your places that it'd be silly not to mention, like your ICWs, your Discoveries. I would like ambitious targets and stuff down south, like your Rev Pro and your Progresses and stuff like that. Like, who knows what the next year can hold. But in terms of near future, I'll just be looking to wrestle as much as I can against people that can level me up, give me that challenge, and just kind of learn from. Like, I want to wrestle people that are a bit of a name, that have got a bit of stature about them, that I can wrestle and I can take so much away from them, and just be like, yeah, I was able to hold my own in there against those guys, you know, and I think that would be amazing.
I mean, a phrase that's popped up quite often in this season of interviews anyways is iron sharpens iron. So it's always trying to find those people that
yeah.
will move you up. And just today, actually, as we're recording, seeing Kate Calloway get announced for ICW, making her ICW debut. And of course, Daisy's done things through there as well, Daisy Jenkins, and Andy as well. He ended up stepping away, I think, because he has a million other things to do with Power Pro and Mega Slam and everything else that he's doing.
Busy guy these days.
But quite busy, but that seems to be where the door is kind of swinging open at the moment for those opportunities. And they have Rampage up, they have Demo, they've got Demo up on that show with the kids going to be on Wake Me Up at the end of September. So that seems like a surefire bet. If someone at ICW takes a look at you and go, oh my God, we've got to get this guy. I mean, not to objectify you here, but look at you. You know?
I know, right? I'm a freak of nature.
I mean, they've got some big lads there, ICW, Colton Davis, ADM, you know, but just like, look at you. get.
I mean, ADM, ADM is someone I know very well. Wrestled him a couple of times this year. I would love to run that one back, whether it be under the banner of, you know, an ICW. You mentioned Colton Davis there. Up and coming guy. He's also a legit 6'7" guy. All the potential in the world. Spoke to Colton on and off. You know, that's whether it's tag team, whether it's against each other, whether it's whatever it is. I think sooner or later, it's kind of one of those ones where, you know, you've got two legit 6'7" guys. We're always kind of like circling round. We're not kind of, our paths aren't quite meeting yet. But I think it's only a matter of time before we do.
It's like, there's not, I think that's what Scotland's missing, that a little bit, a proper skyscrapers tag team. I mean, you got the guys, you got Grum and Holden over at Fair City that are just two legit big dudes that are going to absolutely leather you and throw you about. But we're missing this kind of.
You need a new Brothers of Destruction.
That's it.
Just a team that just will pag at everyone.
Just you can do rock paper scissors in the back. Who's wearing the mask for it? There's a guy in Power Pro I'm noticing right now. Is he called Payne? Just now, I think he's called. He followed me on Instagram, which was terrifying. The Grim Ripper, I think.
From the Livingston School, yeah.
Yeah. Oh man, he looks. I don't know what height he is, but his look. He looks amazing. So. Possibly, maybe that's gonna be your Kane to your Undertaker.
Even the thing with Colton is, imagine the double chokeslam.
Oh yeah, imagine nobody lining up for it.
There you go.
So anyone want to try this?
Form an order of the queue, guys. I promise it won't hurt that much.
That's incredible to think of. I don't want to focus on tag team stuff, even though now mine's just going. Oh, we get. Get Cody Crawford's and get your, like you mentioned, your ADMs, get all these, just, you know what, Just give me a promotion.
Not even tag teams, just those are kind of guys that you'd love to go against.
Just give me a promotion with beefy guys. I mean, we've got Shay did his amazing Pride event recently for I'm Coming Out. Just, I would love a promotion that is solely focused, maybe a one-off show. I think down south, I can't remember who though, did a show called Beef. I want a Scottish version. Just get all these big lads in. There's going to be maybe three moves. Yeah. I don't care. It's going to be a load of big lads just absolutely leathering the shit out of each other for a couple hours.
Have a legit heavyweight tournament. That's what I want to see. Like King of the Ring style, heavyweight tournament, heavyweights only, heavyweights, super heavyweights. Just get all the big guys from Scotland, a few from England, and just let us leather the absolute out of each other.
I mean, we mentioned a lot of the names already, obviously, because we're an hour in and I haven't made mention. Got through Aspen in there as well. That's how you get Rampage up. No, this could be a thing. I mean,
exactly.
Pitch it to Andy.
I mean, the market is wide open for it, to be honest.
I know he's busy with just tackling the whole country, UK of shows, but you know, I think Power Pro could fit in a Power Pro Beef Fest somewhere.
December show is coming up. December 12th was the night of the Wrestling 3. Who's to say that I'll not get another big guy to wrestle to really test me, to level me up? Just two big guys in the ring battering lumps out of each other.
Make a triple threat and just get Omar in there just to close that chapter and just have Colton. Three
if it was,
there you
if
go.
It was Omar, it'd be 2-on-1. It'd be me and someone else battering him because of his just insolence.
I don't think tickets are available yet, but they might be by the time this episode goes out. If that sells you, just
goes... if you book that, no disqualification, just me and another guy battering Omar, then sold out within minutes.
And with that, I think that's a nice kind of time to start moseying on to the finish. So like I said, Battle Lines October 20th. This is the big match that's coming up. You and TJ Rage. It's the rematch of the century. It's the Pro2 Airshare Believe Championship. Say that five times fast. Title on the line. People get your tickets for that. We've talked about what you want to do and what's coming up, and hopefully Omar will be dealt with by the time the year 2025 rolls around. But
by the time this comes out, who knows what he's going to be talking about? Do you know what I mean? Like sending you more paragraphs, no doubt.
No, I mean, we might have him on, but by the year end, that could be a interesting, if the anonymous messaging is anything to go by, it could be an interesting night. But with that, plug your social media. Is there anything, I don't think I've forgotten anything that's pressing. Is there any matches, proud matches you've had in the last year that we haven't spoke about that you think needs to be aired out, needs to be talked about?
I touched on the Fatal 4-Way, the match with EDM. Frank Gallo was one of my favourite matches at Pro2. What else? I'm actually debuting for Target on October 5th. October 5th, I think it is.
Ooh.
In Carlisle. I think me and Andy are going down for that one.
Oh, that'd be...
Debut for Target. And yeah, Battle Lines, October 20th. Heavyweight title match. Keep your eyes open for that one. And new...
That's what we're gonna get. I'll have the results ready. Get the old new in capitals. I'm sure. But with that, plug your stuff. Where can people find out more about Hunter Samson?
On Instagram, I am Hunter Samson Pro. I think I'm the same on Twitter, and on Facebook, I am Hunter Samson.
Perfect. Easy as that. Thank you very much for taking the time. I think we did okay ramble wise. I think we're safe. Other than
for this 10 minutes, it was all right.
Give me another 5 minutes, and we'll I'll be asleep probably. Not because of yourself, because I've got 2-year-old. But with that, thank you very much.
That was perfect timing for that. That was perfect timing. Watch Omar clip that one.
Perfect. Thank you very much for taking time to speak to me, and good luck for October 20th.
No worries, man. Always a pleasure.